It is a part of my duty in a service like this to remind each of us, myself included, that what we have just heard, what we have just prayed, the promises of Scripture, the promises of God Almighty Himself are trustworthy and true, not simply in an abstract sense, but with holes in our heart that we feel right here and right now. Not just dusty words from a dusty book, but the very promises of God that are good even on a day like today, even in a loss like this. Most certainly for a woman like my mother-in-law, who took each of these promises as the God's honest truth. They are good for her. They are good for each of us. And it's my duty then, even amidst tears, to remind ourselves of that. That it is Jesus Himself who says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." For she is now at rest. She was weary and heavy laden for many years. 6 years, a survivor of pancreatic cancer, a disease that even still only has a single-digit survival rate past year one. We were graced by God with 6 years. And even though it broke our hearts, we were graced by God that in a moment, in an instant, that burden was relieved. And that weariness was finished. At rest, at peace, at joy, for she fought the good fight. She ran the good race. She most assuredly kept the faith. And now, my dear mother, rest in the peace of God. Rejoice in His presence. Shine in His glory. And welcome us on the day of resurrection. Dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God Himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And He who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Those things which hurt so bad every day, made new. Those things which were weak and wasted away, made new. Those things that tried to eat her up from the inside out, made new. Our own broken hearts and our griefs and the hope within our lives, made new. It is a promise of God. She believed that promise. I do too. You can as well. Behold, not in some abstract future, He who sits upon the throne says, "Right here, right now, I am making all." No more mourning or crying, not in His glorious day, which frankly I don't feel right now. I got some mourning, a little bit of crying. Not every tear has been wiped away just yet, at least not for us. For her, at rest, at peace, at joy in God's glory and made new. And for that I'm grateful. And for that I'm thankful. That He who gave us such a good gift in her has now drawn her into His loving presence. And that good fight is done. And because Jesus has one, she has two. But these were promises not from some guy wearing purple, some dude with a black shirt and a white collar. But these are the promises of God Almighty Himself. And my mother must stake her life on them every single day. And I do too. A momentary affliction, though it seems like it was a long, long time for us, is now over, and an eternal weight of glory. She who may have seemed like a jar of clay, these last few years, maybe not much to look at, maybe not have caught your eye, as she got smaller and smaller. At first, kind of happy that she was able to lose weight again. And yet, within that jar of clay, so simple and so seemingly ordinary, was a treasure of Christ Himself, with a love that shone out so bright and so easy. It shone out so beautifully and so well. It was a power that does not exist within us by ourselves, through our will, by our goodness, but by the grace of God Himself. That's why we can say at a time like this that we are crushed, that we are afflicted but not crushed, perplexed but not driven to despair. We are persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed. A day like this hurts. A loss like this breaks us from the inside out, but this is not the end. We may take hope. We may take encouragement. It is our hope in the resurrection, but it is God's promise. God keeps His promises. So even in a day of sadness and grief, we may take our assurance in that. Because it's been heard.
Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning, my morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Faithful to her. Faithful to us. His mercies will not end. Do not despair. Every morning new, and it is the faithfulness of God which is great. He has not forgotten her. He will not forget you as well. When I say that it's my duty to connect these promises of Scripture to the here and to the now, for it's not just anyone who has died, it is someone. It is someone real and someone true and someone who we miss greatly and deeply even now. I can't help but to see these promises, again, not as an abstraction, but as something very concrete, because I saw them lived out every single day by her. As I mentioned, you want to see strength? You want to see courage? We saw it all the time. Physically, she might have gotten a little smaller all the time. Her spirit only grew. Strength only multiplied, and her bravery unimpressed even now. I think of the promises of God that I saw shine through her so easily and so brightly and so well. The sort of promises that I think are why you're here. For lives that she touched, for love that she showed, for relationships that she built. I learned a lot about family and about love from her. I learned,
boy, Angel,
that having five kids sounds like a lot, but it's actually a pretty good number. I learned that you ought to fill your house with love and with joy and let the kids run at least a little while. I learned that your bed is in actuality the family. And that, believe it or not, all seven people can really cook. I learned that rice goes with everything, but most especially homemade fricassee. I learned, no matter the time of day, it's never too late for just a little cafecito. I learned that your own words for songs are sometimes better than the original lyrics. Why not? I learned that no matter how busy you are, how many demands, how many pressures, there's always time to feed the ducks. I learned that when your cell phone reception is bad, you can always ask the person on the other line, can you get where going? I learned that life was worth living, and with gusto, and with happiness, and with joy. And it doesn't matter if you know the words or not, sing along and dance if you can. And go ahead and dance even if you can't. Suck the marrow out of life, and while you're at it, suck the marrow out of bones, too. I learned that you ought to love fiercely and sacrificially and unconditionally. Love your family with all you've got, and love your friends like they're your family. Encourage constantly, give generously, respect everyone. Never stop fighting. You don't quit, and you don't give up. And I learned that when the storms of life come, and they most assuredly will, you don't cower in a corner. You grow apart. My mother-in-law, in essence, was an artist. She didn't work to sculpt clay, to paint with brushes. She was an artist, and her medium was love. And through that artistry, she made very ordinary things extraordinarily beautiful. And I believe we are each part of that handiwork. A part of that legacy. A part of that portrait painted all life long. Out of love. In word. In action. And in truth. Because my mother-in-law chose something a long time ago. She chose, and it has rippled across each of our lives ever since, that no matter what would happen, she would live la vida loca. And as I think about it, how crazy was it for her to raise a family the way that she did? How crazy was it to leave her island home that she loved? How crazy was it to marry a surgeon of all things? How crazy was it to bounce around and then find a home in South Florida, to have way too many kids, to involve herself in way too many things, to constantly give of herself for the care of others, for philanthropic causes, to manage an office, to drive all over to be with children and grandchildren, to receive a terminal diagnosis and say, let's dance and have a party anyway. That's La Vida Loca. I don't care what the song says. Dancing and singing and drinking, man, that's for lightweights. You want a real crazy life, it's this one. That gives up herself fully and completely to all she needs. That's the kind of crazy I want to be. The kind of crazy that says, no matter what, you cannot steal my joy, because it is not dependent on my circumstances, it is dependent upon my heart, which belongs to Jesus my Lord. Therefore, I will share it freely and with all, no matter what. That's crazy! Who does that anymore? Well, that's the kind of crazy I want to be. It's the kind of crazy I saw in her. It's the kind of crazy that I think makes a difference in this life. It makes a difference to other people. And it's the sort of crazy that I hope that I can be for my family. Because that's the sort of crazy I got out of her. The sort of crazy that says that love is stronger than hurt. That family is stronger than any sickness. Jesus is stronger than death. Crazy. But I saw it from her, and I happen to know for a fact that it's true. It has been a crazy night. But a good one. One that she was thankful for and blessed. Every day. And I have been too. Of all of those days, I have been able to share with her, for the family, she privileged me to be welcomed into. So whether she called you Rubio, Lorita, Papinka, oh, amor. This beautiful artist has marked us forever. And she is not lost to you, nor to any of us. She loved you. Special Puerto Rican crazy, I guess. That's what I want, too. Right after she died, as the family started to gather there in the home, we slept, some of us, in the office. If you look near the back of your bulletin, you'll see a picture of what I found on the frame there in the office. Every Sunday at church, I used to make these verses over the week for people to read and to keep. And boy, she kept a ton of them. They're everywhere. The plastering, the fridge, and everything else. But there in the office, in a place of work or privacy. There weren't any other verses, just these three, and they were there displayed on this frame. And as I contemplated my grief and also my thanksgiving for her life, to be able to see those three verses in particular encapsulated better than I know how to do, how she lived her life and the sort of crazy I want to be from here on out. From 1 John, "Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and with truth." Mark 10:45, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And I saw it and I knew it every day. She does it even still, pointing to the love of Christ our Savior, which is sacrificial, which is strong, which is true, and which never, ever, ever ends. Therefore, the Philippians, I thank my God every time I remember you. And I will every time I remember her. It seemed crazy to go on and on about a woman such as this. But if you knew her, and I suspect you did, you know just how worth it it is and how crazy in thanksgiving and in love we ought to be. So be crazy like her. The love of God might shine forth from you and paint a beautiful portrait of love everywhere you go and for everyone you meet. La vida loca is here within our grasp, thanks to this good woman, this good gift from a very good God. And in gratitude and in love, you can be crazy just like her. So, hazlo por ella. Do it for good.
Is entitled Mi Corazón. I have never seen a more beautiful woman. Told me to follow my passions.
kissed my cheeks, held my hands, falling asleep, telling me to follow my dreams, staying awake long enough to make sure I knew how much she loved me. I'm tempted to cry. I'm tempted to never stop crying. But she wanted me to chase the world. She told me every day I saw her, in her honey accent and with her kind eyes, and I know she would want me to stay now, for us to remember. She used to sit by the water in a chair, where the sun kissed her and the breeze danced in her hair, and then she'd walk back inside and continue life. Then with time, she used to be asked to be sat by the water in her chair, so that for a few moments the sun could kiss her and the breeze could meet with her hair. And then she'd be asked to be brought back inside and fight with life. And we forget in our loss, now that she's walking the edge of the earth and the sky by the water and where the stars, where the sun can kiss her forever, and she is the breeze dancing in our hair. We may miss her, but her and life have had their time, and now it is our turn to walk back inside, to face the world, to hold the hand of the sun and remember the way that she's kissed each of our lives. And you do not have to forget that there was never a more beautiful woman than our Lucita. Thank
you. Quisiera en este momento dar las gracias primeramente a Dios por el privilegio y el honor que me ha dado de tener una hermana como nuestra familia, su hermana Lidia, que está con nosotros también, mi tía Neida, mi primo María, Lisa y Joey, que me acompañan hoy. Les queremos dar las gracias por estar con nosotros en este momento. Mi hermana, yo la llevo en mi corazón por siempre. Siempre ha estado conmigo. Nunca nos ha abandonado. Mi padre es un Puerto Rico, que aunque ya la quiero, siempre, siempre, nunca estaban con ella. Nunca sintieron distancia entre donde estaba en la Florida y Puerto Rico. Cada momento importante de la vida de mi hermana, mis padres estaban con ella acompañándola. Así es que nos sentimos privilegiados por haber tenido una hermana como Mimi. Gracias por estar con nosotros. Los queremos mucho. Amén.
Thank you. was the words of the creed, you know, I believe in the resurrection and the life, and I do. I do. So it's a little bit of an existential crisis for me to try to figure out why it is I'm so troubled and sad. Because I am sure, as sure as I can be, of such things, that there is a life after this, and there is a good God who, by His grace, defeated death for me, for you, for Mimi. But I feel still this loss and struggle. I'm trying to figure out what it is and what it means. I wonder what it might have been like to maybe watch Mozart play the piano, even for a moment, and watch Grace Kelly dance, or Leonardo da Vinci sketch a face. I don't know, but I imagine they might have made it look easy. I think that's part of genius, to make difficult things look effortless. Because the truth is, it's not easy to play the piano like Mozart. It's not easy to dance like that or to draw like that. I think it's something people call grace. And a hard thing is done with ease, and it makes everyone watching want to try. Maybe even believe, just for a moment, they believe they could do it, too. I think to watch this woman love someone is like that. She just made it seem easy to do that. But it's not easy, actually. It isn't. Really, to love a person, it's hard, actually. When you love a person over the course of their life, it's hard. And to put up with their faults and their foolishness, it's hard. It's one of the hardest things that human beings do with each other, to really accept flawed people without judgment or prejudice. It's difficult. To choose to simply, when we say it, we want to do it, we believe that we're capable of it, but we don't really do that, not really to accept people without prejudice, to simply joyfully embrace someone utterly, totally, fully. I'm a witness that this woman did that with people, with everyone in her life. I had the privilege of being a part of this family for 24 years, and I can tell you, she was never once mad at me. At least I never knew that she was mad at me. And that's crazy. I mean, if you know me, plus you wouldn't know me, that's not believable. That a person wouldn't be angry at me in all that time. She never raised her voice at me. I never once felt disapproval from her. Do you understand how miraculous that is? And maybe if we had time and everyone sort of could stand up and bear witness, you might say the same thing. I just don't think that's ordinary. And I think it deserves, I don't know, a moment of something, awe, gratitude. It's not just me, it's not just that she adopted me, she adopted everyone, really, into that magical place that was her family. She really never gave the impression I was anything other than loved, included, or accepted. And I'm just saying, it's hard to do that. It's like maybe we were in the presence of Jesus. She made it look easy. She made forgiveness look easy, it isn't. She made acceptance look easy, it isn't. She made security stranger. She was secure, she made other people feel secure. She made that look easy, it isn't. These are elusive things for human beings, things we chase after and can't seem to grasp. She made it all look easy. It's not like she was good at everything. I mean, I don't think we can put her up for sainthood or something. I don't know, maybe we could, but I don't know if we'd be that or maybe I don't know. Okay, maybe we can tell them later. It's not the point. The point is not so much that she was perfect. It's that, and I really believe this, it's that the thing that most matters to human beings, the bit of us that's the most important part of us, our ability to love, to make other people feel valued or important, she did that better than the rest of us. Of all the competencies a person could chase or pursue, I don't even know, she carried such weight and gravity, and yet did it with such a playful heart, a light heartedness. I think that's part of it too, part of the genius of it, part of the mystery of it. She was not, in my view, self-conscious, and I think it's so rare. She loved people but wasn't looking for something from them in return for that love, which is so rare. Kind of no strings attached, which was a gift. She gave herself like a gift to the world around her, to the people around her. You know what? She gave people permission to be themselves. Totally. Not really. It's what it's like to be in the presence of someone you feel kind of loves you, kind of cares about you, and yet isn't demanding anything from you. It's really something. She allowed people permission to be themselves because I think she was always herself. She was comfortable with joy in a way I've rarely seen. She carried in her a kind of innocence. When she was about 67 years old, she still felt more innocent than me, younger than me. She was kind of carried out like a wonder about the world. About people. We were trying to kind of come to the right word, and it's not naivete, it's innocence. The right word is purity. Purity of heart. She carried around hope for people. Like you could feel it when you were with her. Like she had hope for you, maybe even more hope than you had for yourself at that given moment. And she had a kind of stubborn, at least in my view, a kind of stubborn resistance to the dark things of this world. When she had money, it did not make her materialistic. When she had friends, it did not make her proud. In the end, when she had pain, it did not make her bitter. She was never greedy, or impatient, or angry. I think we have to call that grace. She was always simply who she was. She gave not out of something we need to be needed, but just, I don't know, out of some kind of abundance, some well that she was drawing from that ordinary people don't have access to or something. I don't know. I really don't know. But I saw it. I was witness to it. And I testify today to that reality. Something about sunlight. You know, Monica looks a little bit like her mom and cooks, praise God, cooks like her mom. Loves a little bit like her mom. And they have this sort of love for the sun, for sunlight. It's a Puerto Rican thing. Always making homes with windows. That let light in, always wanting to be near it. And I think she was like that, actually. I think she was like someone. Always, well, time to go from it. Most people live in and out of the shadows. Let's just be honest. It's a dark world, full of dark people with dark hearts and dark motives. And maybe there's good notes, and we come and go from the shadows of our lives, the shadows of our motives, and the shadows of our ways. And this woman just didn't. I don't understand it completely, but I felt like when you were kind of with her in the presence, or in the home that she had made, it was like you were in the presence of sunlight. The shadows were driven away, resisted somehow. She lived in light. This too is grace. I was talking to Rocio last night, just trying to, process this, and asking her to tell me, from her heart, this firstborn daughter, how she feels. And this is the way Rocio put it. She said, "Man, I feel like I was loved so completely by this person. So utterly, so totally loved. And I've lost, I'll never be loved like that again." And I can almost see Rocio kind of playing back that tape of her own life and going backwards and seeing all those times when she didn't feel worthy. That kind of intense, all-encompassing love, and yet it was never ever held back, never once for anything she did or said. And I think we all kind of feel that way a little bit, that it's undeserved. And I think we have to call that grace. That's what grace is. It's a person that loves so utterly, without judgment, without strings. Even when we know we're not worthy of that kind of love, and yet there's this person that just sort of like refuses to see you any other way, refuses to, give in or to fail to hope for you. So this was her gift. To love us, even when we weren't believing, to believe in us somehow, and even when we didn't believe in ourselves, even when we weren't worth believing in. I guess when Mozart died, people probably felt that loss too. They would never hear him play again. All the music he'd ever written was now written. And so all that was left was for those that had heard him to mourn for ourselves. For our lives, because the light had gone out, and there's no denying it. So that's how I feel. I think this was right. I think that a luminary is, we've lost this person, and there's no words that can take it away. I do believe in the resurrection. I do believe that she dances with God today. We are left here in this world, and it's just a little dimmer today. I mean, somebody who's had a baby, quick, they can spit and name that baby Dominga. I just put it out there. Have twins or something to try to make up for the imbalance in the universe or something. But the viewing yesterday, woman stood up and said she never doubted. Somehow was moved by that, touched by that, this sort of unwavering faith. And I think that's true too, and I think that there's something that needs to be kind of remembered about that too, that she had this, still innocence of faith, that she refused to doubt. And that I think I was the recipient of that, and Rocio was trying to say she was the recipient of that, like to refuse to doubt. Stop believing in us. And listen, if she can believe that Rosie is a good person, or that I'm a good person, how much more is sacrifice of God, the demonstration of the love of God to the people of God in the cross of Jesus Christ. This was her stubborn hope. Keep thinking about that, maybe even in reference, but I keep thinking about that moment when Lazarus has died and Jesus comes to the tomb and he's like visiting with the sisters, Mary and Martha, and they're weeping and he's crying. And he turns to them and he says, I mean, this is a crazy thing to say at a funeral, but he turns to them and says, I am the resurrection and the life. I. Whoever believes in me will not die. Although they die, they will live. And that is it. If that wasn't crazy enough, then he turns to Martha, the kind of elder sister grieving, and he says, do you believe that? And that's what I hear God saying to me. Do you believe that? This is our question today. I actually don't think it's as important what Mimi believed. I mean, it's confirmed now for her. But what about you? What do you believe? Do you believe that? There's a story that's told about Leonardo da Vinci when he was painting his Last Supper, that famous painting of the Last Supper. He had a quarrel with another painter. And so when he started painting the faces of the disciples, he decided to paint Judas's face first. You know, Judas was the bad disciple. And so he painted the face of his enemy, his adversary, as Judas's face. And everybody that came by, looking at the painting, was like, no, you didn't. You know, that's a sick burn. Look at that. You know, he chose to depict his enemy in this way. It's like a bitterness that people hold on to. They want to get someone back, or they want to pay them back, or hold on to the crimes that have been done against us, to refuse to forgive, or refuse to love. And it said that when it came time for him to paint the face of Jesus, he couldn't do it. He kept trying different forms and nothing worked, nothing was right, nothing felt right. It was as if God had deserted him in that moment where he had to paint the most important face in the painting. He could not find the face. And he realized in some sort of awakening, in some sort of lucid moment, he realized it's because he had painted the face of his adversary in the face of Judas. And so he immediately kind of painted over it, painted a neutral face. And in that moment of letting go, of releasing of that bitterness, of somehow being more like the Jesus he was trying to paint, it came to him. This is the life that she lived, a life without adversaries. I mean, a life truly loving every single person she came in contact with. I am a witness to it. I mean, all of it. I was the recipient of it. And I think because of it, she was able to, in this life, see the face of Jesus. I love her. I miss her. But I know now that she has beheld that face that we love her. And she is now fully loved the way that she loved us.